So what you'll see here, what's happening, I'm at a website. You can go to this website. It's node.module.club. It's a REBL. It's a live code thing that I wrote. So if you care to give this a try now or later, if you use Node Module Club, you can just—it's a REBL, so you can do live programming in it, similar to if you were to run Node right here. This is a REBL. It's a slightly different flavor REBL, where you can see that it shows you the return and the output of your program as you write it. So var x equals 3. That didn't return anything. X, there's 3. So this is a REBL, read, evaluate, print, loop. REBLs are cool. Good way to test out stuff without committing to a file. Cool thing you can do, though, with in the Node REBL, say you start building something, you know, you say rx equals 3, what am I doing? And var y equals 4, console log x plus y, and say, oh, that's a cool program I made. I can do dot save, cool program, dot js. And now it's been saved there. If I go out, I can see my cool program, so I can continue with it. And then if I want to go back into the REBL again, I can say .load cool program.js, and it'll load it and run it line by line. So that's REBLing for you. It is also sort of the basis of live coding. Live coding is just sort of where, you know, you've got a concept of your program running. It's doing something. Maybe it's on an animation loop or on an audio loop of some kind. So that's what this is over here. This is a REBL. It's my own secret REBL. I'm sharing it with you. You can use it if you like. There's no instructions, so if you want to know the instructions, you should pay attention. The only real instruction is to compile here, you hit shift enter. Whereas over here, you just hit enter. Here, you hit shift enter. So I'll go over a few of the differences so that you can kind of understand it. That's one difference would be, say, if I had the same code here. Now, I'm going to hit shift enter and it's going to compile. But first, I'm going to open my console so that you can see. Now I'm going to hit shift enter. And it did a console log. So this is run. This is basically, the stuff up here is basically as if you're running it down here, except that it doesn't give you the feedback loop unless you look into it. So, you know, I can sit here and compile this over and over again. Shift enter, shift enter, shift enter. It's not really doing anything. But if we look down here, then we see that it did it a bunch of times. We can change that to alert. Alert. So there's that. I can say window open. Somehow I could have made that a pop-up, but so you can see you can interact with the DOM here. What's happening right here is you're just inside of the living website. synths. Remember some of the DOM stuff we had? Document body. So I can say console log document body. Go back down here and look in the console, and there it is. And I could say document body inner HTML. Is that right? Oh, and now it's gone. Nothing but a background. One of my favorite backgrounds. I use it for all my websites. I'll reload. So Shift-Enter is what goes on here. The only other neat trick is that you can require modules, as you've seen in other demonstrations. And if you've been going along with the module pattern and maybe taking a dive into Browserify, basically you can write Browserify programs right here in this little REPL. And I'm going to do that with a focus on music and audio programming. But I'll be using modules, and it'll be downloading them from NPM. And I can show you how I could have just written, it'd be just as if I was writing programs, right here, and then browserifying them. So you'll see it both ways. So I'm going to start with, I'll load up, I'm going to do some coding here. I'll talk about what I'm doing as I'm doing it, and if you have questions, pipe up. I'm right off the bat. I'm going to be blowing a convention, right out of the hall, and whoever notices that can raise their hand and tell me what that convention is. So master is new audio context. Now audio context. Yes, Sam? Semicolons. He said semicolons. You don't have to use semicolons. I almost never use semicolons. That's not the one. I'm going to do that because I don't want that to be the one either. Because I'm using the keyword new and it's JavaScript, I could omit these things. I don't know why, but I'm going to put it there. So the audio context is a API that lives in the browser that is available to you as a programmer to do various audio things with. If you ever want to study up on it, you could search web audio API, take you to some docs. It says these docs are, go to these docs, and here we go. So I refer to these, but this is all the specifics of web audio. But the rundown of what web audio is it's a bunch of little nodes that you can use to patch together music or patch together audio streams. Basically, some of them can create audio streams, some of them can run effects on them, and I'll show you a couple of them. I don't actually use all of them. I use a few specific ones, and then I'll show you why I use them. But so right here, I'm writing a program, master equals new audio context. So I'm creating a new audio context. I'm calling it master. This is, you might normally call something master. It's the in your audio graph, your stack or whatever. The master. It's the final destination. Now, I'm going to say JSON equals require JSON. So here's that require stuff. Using it right here in the browser. These modules are published, open source, available on NPM. And I use them all the time. I wrote them. Now, one thing that the Web Audio API gives you is what's called a script processor. And this one right here abstracts that for you into a function. basically. And what a script process, what the script processor does is it allows you to generate or manipulate audio at the very lowest level, which is at the bit, at the sample. So here's the, there's a sample rate associated with what your machine. Your machine's going to pick it for you, and it's going to be right here as a property of master itself. So let me just show you here. Let's see. Oh, see, it kicked in as soon as I created it. It kicked in the signal, I guess. So here's your audio context. Sample rate, 44/100. So sample rates, sample rate in a nutshell is how many, is what happens when you quantize audio into digital stuff. It's when you quantize it. So basically a second of sound gets chopped up into 44,000 samples. And that's what you're working with when you get down to it. That's what's sometimes called DSP, digital signal processing. It's the neat thing about it is that it's essentially the same math that you can use. You can use it to make music, but you could also use it to, you know, it's the same kind of stuff that goes into 3G wireless, and Wi-Fi. You know, signal processing. It's how do you read information from these waves. It's essentially the same stuff, but music uses it a little bit differently. So, anyways, I'm going to continue here. I'm requiring three modules straight out of the internet. And now I'm defining my root function. Is there really an owl during my presentation? this function right here is really kind of the root of it. This function is going to run 44,000 times per second. And what it returns is the actual sample that is used to build audio, you know, musical audio waves. So literally every single quantized bit of sound is going to be generated by this function right here. With the help of some other functions.
Hey, Jenny, what's in the blue? It's kind of hard to see.
All right. This is a... Let's see what I can do about this. That didn't help. Sorry about the blue. I'll highlight it. You know, tell me when that needs to happen. So the three arguments here that are going to be supplied to this function are time, the sample, which is would be the actual sample, you know, out of 44,000 or whatever, and then an input, just in case there was an input. For instance, a microphone. I can turn the microphone into a web audio node, and then I can connect it to this one right here. And I'll show you some of that in a minute. And I'll show you how, like, I'll run effects directly on the microphone, effects that I'll be writing right here. So, now, actually I'm going to call this DSP. That's the digital signal processor right there. And now we're going to create a synth. So we'll say synth equals jsynth master DSP, and I'll just put this here for safety. So what's happening here is I'm referencing this first module that I'm requiring, and I'm passing it this DSP function sort of as a callback, and it's going to use that. Basically, it's going to say master create a script processor node and chop up the samples. Whatever this function returns for each of the samples, that's what, you know, is going to be kicked out to the output, which is right here at connect to So here, creating a synth using that module and this function, and then connecting the synth to the master destination. Master destination is your final, is the final out because of the speakers. So now, what's going to happen here? We've got this function. Oh. Inside of this function, we're going to have this other function happen. Now, this one right here, so I've got these three kind of core functions I'm playing around with. I've called this one Oz, just short for oscillators. It's a module that has a bunch of oscillators. Each one is, you know, maybe three lines of code, but it's nice to have them all in one place. So down here you can see Oz sine. That's a sine function. Another sine function, well, I won't even get into it. See, because I've written a thing, and this is going to create a sine function. So now, I'm going to compile all this. Yeah. Oops. So. I'm going to do a little trickaroo here. So what I've done now is I've changed that function that's going to get called every time. I'm going to have it reference another function up here. Because I want to later be able to change it, and I think this will work. Just check. Anyways, I think this will work. So, before I blow us all out of the water again, might I turn this down? Error. What is the error? Oh, that's the error. Shorten it down. So, what I did was I added this other third module. It's called AMOD for, it's short for amplitude modulator. This function takes four arguments, a center, a radius, so to speak, time, and then a frequency. And so basically this is saying, multiply the sine wave signal by somewhere between 1, 0, and 1. Because 0.5 is our center and 0.5 is our radius, and it's going to go around the radius, so to speak. So it's going to do it every 6 seconds, which is why it's going slow. Let's see this. So let me just talk about this for a sec. The sine wave here. It's kicking out a sine wave. You heard it. That's just your sine wave right there. It's a 54 hertz, very low frequency sine wave. And that's what this oscillator function does. It says, over time, at a certain frequency, I'm going to tell you what the values are. So that's what's happening with this. Now, multiplication in this domain is basically volume. It can be used to create all kinds of effects because you could modulate volume like super fast and make funny effects or whatever. But essentially, multiplication in the domain of digital signal processing, waves, music waves, alien waves, all the waves, is amplitude. So what this is doing right here is modulating the amplitude in that way that I said before. I changed it from 1/6 to 6 times per second. So I'm thinking 2 times per second. So right here, this is just, I know this parameter. This parameter is the frequency of the amplitude modulator that I wanted to go with. Back here in the thing that I created, there were these three modules. And we'll just like go to npm and search the I showed these last presentation I gave. This is that module. This is the oscillator module. Live and in the text. So what you can see here is I'm exporting these functions. These functions refer to some functional expressions down below. So here's a sine wave. That's a bare sine wave. You take time which would be your x-axis if you're thinking about just two-dimensional geometries over time. You know, you picture that sort of wave thing happening over time. So time is kind of just fundamental to this whole thing. Tau, and then frequency. Tau is 2 times math pi. And that's related to your radiance stuff. So what's happening then over here is I'm requiring this module. This module is giving me all of these functions. And then I run these functions inside here. Now, these two functions occurred for this reason, I'll tell you. This function is going to be used by jsynth, the first module. And what it's going to do is it's going to call that function to get all the values that it needs to generate the audio. Well, I had it refer to another function that lived out here so that I could continually redefine what it was. So it was always going to be looking for music, this function music, and passing. It's just going to pass these arguments to music. So, but now I can go and keep redefining music over and over again to change things live. Envelopes and effects. requiring yet another module called JDelay. And it's a delay. It works just like a delay, but you can control it with programmatic parameters instead of, you know, knobs and levers that stop at one point or the other. And I'm going to do this. Let's see. Another one in here. Let's call it Mike. So far, nobody has called me out of my convention breaking. Just want to say that. So I wrote this other one, this other module. Mike. It returns a function. I'm going to do this little shorthand. Since basically, this is a function. I'm just going to call that function right now and pass master to it because it needs it. Everything is global?
Yeah, that's the convention.
That is the convention. I am not using var for any of these things. I'm making them all global.
Why?
Because I do want to be able to access them after a different compilation. Because each compilation is going to go through some closures, basically, and I'll lose scope. So if I used var, if I said var mic later on, I wouldn't be able to access it because it would be stuck in a closure. But this way, it just makes it global, and I can always refer to it, which becomes handy when you've got a lot of stuff going on. So, my delay back in here too. Now the music function, as you can see, is going to seem to have an error somewhere. Okay, so what we see here now is the microphone got connected to the synthesizer. We have a delay on the input.
I'm going to
So what I'm going to do next is just some demonstration. I'm going to take some of these things to a farther level, and then I'm also going to invite some people to plug into some effects. Actually, I'll show you something. Here's an ugly one. Let's look at this. This one uses, it actually doesn't need all of these things. You know, what I get to hacking and just start adding things just so they're there for me. But this one is going to take a microphone input, and then, well, it's going to take an input, whatever it is, and then it's going to modulate the pitch for that one. And, first we'll hear this on my voice, and then we'll hear it on some guitar. So again, this is just like that code on the website, except this is just on a file. So this is some browserify code, some node code, some regular stuff. I've got this little fancy program that I wrote that does some of that stuff for me. This actually sounds really cool with some guitar. So I'm gonna start just making music. And demoing some of these other modules, so like right here I can show you I've got these modules for not just for oscillators, delays, amplitude modulators, but for timekeeping, so for doing time-oriented things, envelopes for creating actual beats, or you know, shaped music, so. And then I've even got an overtone module that does overtones to create different instruments. And you know, if you watch for long enough, I'll show you using some of that. And how using different overtones create different types of sounds, like knocking sounds or bassy sounds or violin sounds or trumpety sounds or things like that. So I'll get into that. But I'm gonna try to get the grooves going and more or less bring the sit down portion of this to an end. So with that, I'm gonna invite up Daniel right here. He's gonna plug in his guitar to this madness and get us going with some grooves, and then I'm gonna do some coding, and we'll see how this works. I'm gonna start this one up right here, this kind of more complex one, and show you what all some of that can do. So there's this other module called Teoria, and it does a lot of handy abstraction of modal music for you, jazz music and such, to give you like all of your different modes and scales and keys and whatnot. So once we get going with those things, then it might actually sound like something. Let's just see where this was at when I left it. I can't get my wander. It's probably not going to be very good. Ours is going to break. Show you a little bit what's happening here, just to give you a little rundown. I've got a timer here that's doing 74 BPMs right here, and then I use that timer to create things, right? So right here, every quarter beat, and here every eighth beat. Modulus math here. music or scales and stuff, but I don't need to. So now I've got these notes. Let's just, well, before I do that, let's just see what this changes things. To require this module first. Teoria. Okay. Look, I'm going to just flip it up right here to Locri mode. This didn't do much. Let's go with Ionian I. I don't know about that. Y'all ever heard of Mixolydian? Me neither. I don't even know how to spell it. What? Like that? No? Well, what does it sound like? So actually, I'm gonna add yet another thing here. We don't need that one. We need beat math. This is a stupid module. And now I'm gonna create, say beats. Do I remember how to use this? Yes. I think say 21. I don't know. Oh no. Let's see what the error was. Jeez, I'm sure it's not defined. Oh, that's cold. Ah, there it is. Thank you. Close bracket. So, a handy way of, so B here, I've got this B thing. This B, it comes one of the parameters, one of the arguments for this function. That's the beat count in this program. It's the beat count. Let's make this a little simpler to understand. So, oh shoot. Anybody want to pick the next root note or scale? Would that be this? Is that a G minor? No. I know my alphabet. No, whenever I think about the notes of the music, I'm always like A, B, C. I have to do it every time. That's a little demonstration of some of those things. What's happening down here, though? Oh, boy, I don't even know. Kind of. Get into this. That's good. I killed it. So, that was a rough thing. I'm going to keep playing that. I'm gonna go back and pick that back up and get some beats going. And let's did you get that running over there? Let's see if we can hear this. So that's running is a it's an effect that does a pitch shift and then a delay on top. And it was working just fine earlier. This is kind of what it looks like when you're trying to throw an interface on top of your synthesizers. This is an interface controlling a few delays. I don't know why we're getting such weird audio quality, but kind of comes with the territory. Thank you. this synthesizer right here, for effects, what it does is it has a tempo bound.